The subject of Stephen Knight's interview in 1973 was a man named Joseph Sickert, son of the renowned Victorian painter Walter Sickert.
But you presented a tale that I regard as the finest I have ever written. You embarked on a course that would take you through 18 months of mystery, intrigue, controversy, and a story that, once read, makes Watergate look like a Sunday school picnic, really, doesn't it?
Yes, it does, very much so.
Whitechapel victim number one, Mary Ann Nichols.
She was in her 40s. She was very down at heel, much the worse for drink most of the time because, well, as with all the victims, that was the only solace they could find in life. She was laid out and her intestines were sort of cut out and there was a general mutilation in the genital area. Her throat was cut from left to right.
This time, once again, a prostitute in her mid-40s, Anne Siffy, otherwise known as Annie Chapman.
She again was laid out. At her feet were laid out several trinkets. There were two rings, two brass rings, laid side by side, and two mint-condition brass farthings, laid edge to edge. And she was even more mutilated, far more appalling injuries than Mary Nichols. Long Lestrade was found murdered in a backyard or a courtyard adjoining the a socialist club in Stepney, south of Commercial Road. Catherine Eddowes was discovered, as I say, 45 minutes later in Mitre Square, Aldgate. The first victim, Stride, the only injuries she had was a cut throat, which, as I said, has led some people to say she wasn't a Ripper victim at all. Her throat was cut from left to right. The second victim, Catherine Eddowes, was horribly cut about. Her.
I want to talk about the final victim, Marie Kelly.
Yes, she was butchered like an animal. At the same time, there was this element of ritual. She was laid out on her own bed. She is the only victim to have been discovered indoors. Nobody has researched the case deeply enough to have discovered this central point. Out of all the prostitutes in London, 80,000, Jack the Ripper killed five. And all these people representing the killings as random maniac killings just do not consider that these women all knew each other. Two of them lived in the same house. Three of them lived in the same street, and all of them rubbed shoulders daily in the same pub.
Amazing.
Which is 20 yards from where Mary Kelly was killed. Sickert told his son, and his son told me, that the women were murdered according to Freemasonic ritual. That much of their ritual is based on murder. They are a secret society. Some of their basic rituals are the mime of mythical murders. Some taken from the Bible, some taken from Egyptian myth. And these murders are the cutting, or let's take one example. The sign of the entered apprentice, the lowest rank of Freemasonry, is the cutting of the throat from left to right. All the Ripper victims had their throats cut from left to right. At another degree, Jack the Ripper was not one man, but three.
Are we looking at three actual rippers, three people who had knives and scalpels in their hands and did the cutting, or are we talking about one specialist and two accomplices?
We're talking about two killers and one accomplice.
And here
lies Jack the Ripper.
This grave?
That's it.
William Withy Gull.
That's him. The man in charge of the Ripper operation. He was put in charge of it by Lord Salisbury. He'd already committed Annie Elizabeth Crook to an asylum.
He was a high-ranking Freemason, and then something strange happened. He was an incredibly bizarre man. He was of a very strange turn of mind. He decided that it would be just so dangerous to commit the other women that they had to be killed. And so that's how he went about it.
The man who did the cutting, the Chief Ripper, lies there.
Yes. Physician in Ordinary to Queen Victoria. Sickert said that the man who drove the hansom cab was John Netley. He was recruited to drive the death carriage of William Gull, and he also laid the bodies out in the Masonic way. And then I realised that the evidence had been staring me in the face all along. The third man was Walter Sickert. He was forced into it, virtually, by Gull and Salisbury and all the rest of the Masons.
Yes.
Because he had been involved from the beginning. He knew Mary Kelly, he knew Annie Crook, and he could lead them to Mary Kelly. Who else had painted that picture which Netley had used to question people in the East End? And there is, in fact, extant a picture called Blackmail, which very closely resembles a picture of Mary Kelly in the newspapers of the day. Walter Sickert, in old age, came to think he was Jack the Ripper after a stroke. He used to roam the East End of London, dressed in clothes like the Ripper.
My word, really?
Yes, absolutely. He told his son that he painted the truth about the Ripper killings into his painting. Mr. Lusk, sir, I send you half the kidney I took from one woman, preserved it for you. T'other piece I fried and ate. It was very nice. I may send you the bloody knife that took it out if you only wait a while longer. Signed, Catch Me When You Can, Mr. Lusk. Mr. Lusk, Mr. Lusk, Mr. Lusk.
Thank you.